Oh, good morning, good morning. My name is Rick Noda. I'm here in beautiful Encinitas, California. I am the founder of T3 Talks and the host here today for you, where we tighten tactical and transition. Well, you guys can tell by my voice, boy, did we have a great effing time yesterday. All right, but I am so pissed today because I have been looking around on Instagram. Now, just for you guys to know, I do not like go look at YouTube videos. Even though I make YouTube videos and things like that, I'm not one that owns watches TV news and things like that. But I'm going to tell you, I am fucking pissed off right now because you know what? This is National Law Enforcement Week, and there's been a lot of officers that have fallen. And you know what? That one effing day, you guys, one effing day? Come on. Seriously. Like, my buddy Moses and all my friends who are cops, we give them one, it's a week. You know what I heard on the radio today? It's national, or 30 days of masturbation month. And the guy on the radio program that I listened to on the way in has a guest on. Guess what? No cops, no police officers. Why is that? And I'm going to say right now, because we don't give a fuck. Yeah, have I ever used in any of my YouTube videos that much profanity? That answer is no. So you could see the level of aggressive and anger that I am. Because you know what, you guys? Go back 3 videos. Go back, you know, for when I talked about leadership and mentorship, you guys. When an officer approaches you, does he kind of like look clean cut? Most of them do, right? Most of them are family members, all right? They have kids. And despite the danger they put themselves in, they're pretty level-headed at times. Now, me and Esteban, before we started shooting today, we discussed that, you know what, in a previous video, we saw that one guy in the Chicago PD fired his weapon 6 times. But boy, oh boy, is there still a whole lot of things about cops being crazy, excessive force being used, and all of that stuff. Where is the, during National Law Enforcement Week, is the memorial of those that we have lost? Why isn't it that Channel 5, NBC, CBS, and all these stations are not dedicating their time to talk about those individuals who have done great in the community? I just saw an article while I was looking through Facebook and YouTube that there's a local department that really went into a local school and they use canines to show the guys like me suffer from ADHD and at times it's called special education, how to use the companion dogs or the German shepherds or their dogs to literally help them navigate against dangerous areas. Now, where did that story go? That went on the back page of the it wasn't even the interpreter, Esteban. It was like, I had to like dig for it. It's not like but you know what I saw? Cardi B's new ass, you know? I saw some stupid shit from the Kardashians. I saw some douchebag, and I'm sorry to say that, who'd never heard Leonard Skinner. He had 16,000 views, and all he talked about, like, I'm sorry, there goes that Southern accent again. I got to use my New York accent. The guy didn't talk like that. But really? I mean, 16,000 views because the dipshit didn't know about Leonard Skinner, one of the greatest bands out there that created, you know, some of the most anthems out there. And big wheels come on turning. Carry me home just like you. This 20-something-year-old dipshit doesn't know about him, and you out there show him love? Now, here's what I'll tell you. No one wants to talk about death. But you know what? It's the only thing that's freaking guaranteed. Esteban, I can tell you right now, one thing, I will die. I just don't know when. That's it. So my wife constantly asks me, will you leave me? And my answer is yes. Why is that? Because I will die. Here's what I will tell you about death and why it's important. Because at 18 years old, when I signed my will as a Marine, and it's funny. Oh, I leave to my mom a sea bag. I leave to my brother my boots. Because at 18, I didn't have anything. But here's something, another thing about death. When we lose an officer in the line of duty, what ripple effect happens on that family? No one cares, and no one ever does that cover story. Because once that income is lost, all right, who raises those children afterwards? You know who does? Other officers. Oh, yeah. So it's just like the mafia in the gang, or a gang. If a guy goes to prison in the mob world, they try to take care of his family. That integrity isn't as much as it used to be, but I hope it's still there. But in law enforcement, they're a band of brothers. So it's really incredible, just like my Marine brothers, is that when we lose someone, they band together. And when I mean band together, they're not, you know, taking a little food over for the first week. No, they're ensuring that those kids that they had have scholarship money. They also make sure that if that mom needs help, an officer will come in and help as a role model. Yes, as a role model, because that father figure has gone away. You don't hear stories about that, do you? Because we're afraid of death. Now, here's a little story about me that most people don't know what they ask you to do. They may have changed this policy, but I don't know. When I was getting ready to go to Kuwaiti Liberation, all right, and that right there was the second time again that Saddam Hussein had brought his troops over to the front line. We're about to go invade. And sent out advance party. Now, advance party for the unit that I was with kind of goes before all the stuff is out there. And then all of a sudden, then the regular troops start coming in there. So as you're getting your gear together and getting all this stuff together, before you leave, and Esteban's going to probably be blown away by this, is you have to write your death letters to your family. Dear Mom, I love you so much. Thank you for being there for me. Go think of that for a freaking second. I'm going to shut my mouth. Did you write your own letter? How does it sound? It's like writing your own obituary, all right? So when at 18 years old, do you think I'm afraid of death? That answer is no, brother. You know why? Because it's right in front of you. And just like muscle memory, you start to go after it. At 48 years old, I'm a do not resuscitate, DNR. But I understand that our lives. And I have an expiration date here. I don't know if anyone ever knew. We all have an expiration date, like written, tattooed inside our hearts. So death and how we cope with it is why I feel that there's not enough media exposure out there for those officers that have fallen. Now, let's think about this. Let's go back to my previous videos. Now, when we talked on The Interceptor about that study from the Chicago PD from 2014 to 2016, where they looked at 130 officers, and out of 130 officers in that span of time, the amount of officers that had fired their weapon over two times was, and it used a percentage of about 26%. Now, we all remember from the graph that was on that video, at the bottom there, one guy had fired his weapon six times. Now, you know, I'd used a comparison before, my buddy Mo, you can see right here at the graphic again, he's sitting there. And isn't it kind of nice when he sits up nice and tall like a jarhead in that picture there, all right? Is when I talked to him about that, he thought it was kind of funny, you know, because they named the guy, you know? But he mentioned that what's so ironic about that is that in Joliet, where he's from, all right, the statistic would be the same. He asked his other officers, you know, and they were the same. And their sentiment was more like, man, I hope I never have to draw my weapon. Isn't that kind of cool? I mean, they're not out there like I said, like Pac-Man in colors where they're trying to go, bah, bah, bah. They're really good people. They're humans that say, hopefully I don't have to draw a weapon. Hopefully I can communicate what I need. And get that point across by diffusing the situation with my weapon, which is my words. Unlike other like podcasts in this, I don't have a bunch of forgotten officers going behind me. Because what I often like to say is those individuals and those pictures that of those people is intimate to those individuals. So what I rather do and what I love to do is I actually prefer when I have lost someone and think of someone, kind of like reflect on how I was and how I changed my mannerisms to law enforcement as I started to mature. One thing that I will tell you guys is as I was a 15-year-old kid, all right, I was extremely angry because of my ADHD and with my bipolarness. And even though my mother would try to control my sugar intake, I often had run-ins with the police. Woo, woo. All right. Now, you're saying, Rick, no way, not the Marine nurse. There's no way. You know, you were that straight and narrow kid. You were that kid that, wrong answer, brother. Wrong answer out there. Man, I tested everything that was possible. So by the time I got my driver's license and a police officer would pull me over, or I would say the audacity that a cop would pull me over because he's racially profiling a Latino. Now, you guys know I look pretty light, right? Now, even with the hat on today from Panikin, thank you so much. All right. Is, you know, I may look young behind a wheel of a car, but I don't look as brown as I'd like. You know, okay, there in YouTube land, I broke it. I'm Cuban. There it is. Everybody knows. All right. So my attitude towards the police was just like NWE.
Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad because I'm brown.
Just like that. All right. I literally got pulled over one time and did. Fuck the police. Fuck the police. So guess what my ticket looked like? Mm-hmm. No city sticker. No registration was out date. Insurance wasn't in a timely manner. Speeding excessively. Playing his radio excessively. I had five things on my ticket, on that ticket that guy gave me. All right? If there was a citation for being a dipshit, I would have gotten it. As I started to get more and more violent and out of control, and here's what I will tell you, I often started to do more bad things. So I was using this to no do bueno, to do bad. So as I was out there with my cousin, Danny, and we were hustling, those who know what hustling means, when you're hustling and you get pulled over from the cop, and your buddy next to you's got five rocks in his pocket, and you got open containers of little Heineken or little Mickey's Big Mouse in there, and you're about your way to go down to a club, and you have a winker, you have one light off, and a cop pulls you over, guess what you do? You get out the car, which you're not supposed to, but that's what I did, and I handed the young lady my ID that showed that I was a Marine. Now, my cousin decided not to earn the title. I talked to that officer, said, officer, my name is Rick Noda. I'm a Marine. I'm home on leave. She goes, Semper Fi. She goes, do you know you have a light out? I go, yes, ma'am, I do. I said, I was hoping to fix it when I got back tomorrow because this is my brother's car. She goes, do you have insurance and registration? I said, by all means, ma'am, here it is. She goes, Marine, I'm not going to write you a ticket today because you know what? You're here on leave and I really appreciate, you know, that you know, you're in service. Like, you know, when I got out, we talked a little bit about jobs. We talked a little about MOS. I get in the car. Wham! And I freaking cold cock my cousin. And I tell, don't you ever do that again. I said, because the guy you knew that used to use this for bad, that used to say, fuck the police. I don't, because now I am the popo. And I'm not the popo on just a state level. I'm a global police officer where I'm protecting the country from douchebags like you. As we got to the club, I'm sitting there, and my cousin may not remember this, or he does. I had a fistful of money. And as he was sitting there, we were drinking and stuff. Yeah, DUI, dumbass, fucking me. I'm not going to lie. I'm like, oh, I fucking had a designated driver. Nope, real shit comes out of my mouth. All right? So we're sitting there, and my cousin is reaching over the bar and pulling beers out because the bartender's over at the side. And I go to him, I go, dude, we ain't hustling no more, man. I don't need to hustle no more. I got money. I can do this. Sure enough, guess what happens? Security gets called on us because we're buying beers. All right? I do another thing. I go, hey, man, how much are the beers? He goes, da-da-da. There you go. Problem resolved. I didn't hit him again because, you know, we were in a public place. All right? But you guys, you see the difference in earning the title as a Marine. Being a global police officer, an ambassador for the United States, has really, really, really improved the way that my attitude is with law enforcement. Now, the last part of this story and this journey was now I get out. I transition out of the military. Now, if I've been a police officer under the Bill Clinton era, thanks so much for your effing orders, buddy. But no, if I've been, those who've been in, understand what I'm saying. Global police officers, all right? I try my best at, you know, being a LAPD. So me and my buddies go out, we try to do the test. And I'm going to tell you, like from my previous video, I'm not that guy. You know, I failed the test. You know, I like to like shoot first, ask questions later, blah, blah, blah. My verbal judo at the time wasn't the greatest, you know, so I failed. And I said, you know what? Not going to do that. But my friend Moses, my friend Sean, and all those guys started to become police officers. Now, my respect for law enforcement went up another notch because they're taking the teachings that we learned from the Marine Corps and now have added to their skill set as a law enforcement police officer. Now, luckily, I will tell you that I haven't lost any of my friends in law enforcement currently right now. And I think a little bit has to do with their sense of awareness is a little bit higher than some of the other civilians, you know. But it doesn't matter. Lives matter whichever way. But what I will tell you is after this week, again, I'm going to continue to have a different appreciation for my buddies, you know, even though I wear the law enforcement shirts, because you know what? No one fucking cares. And all you're constantly being taught or talked about is that you're a POS. You're a piece of shit. And I'm going to tell you something. If it's under my power and Esteban's power right here, this may be the only channel that I put out there that says, you know what? Police officers are teachers. Police officers are ambassador. And without police officers, all right, what would we do? Esteban said it. When the mortgage crisis happened, oh, we went to the government. Where's the bailouts? When the SHIT hits the fan, who are you going to call? And you ain't calling Ghostbusters. You're going to call the men in blue. So I will tell you that start to understand that your relationship with police officers are and law enforcement are one that you should cherish and understand that that protector is just like that Marine veteran. That Army veteran, that Air Force veteran, that Navy veteran, because their job is to protect you on a daily basis. So I want to thank Panikin not only today for the coffee and also that T-shirt that puts my powers me. I'm a classic man. I'm surprised you guys can even see the camouflage of the Panikin hat because it's cami, it's camo, you guys. Now I often tell you though, our motivation inspires you to be better. But just in case you were wondering, the hair is always still looking good, maybe. I'll see you guys at our next broadcast. Hey, talk to you soon. Thanks for checking out our videos. If you want to go ahead and subscribe, go ahead and hit that button right below. Or if you want to check out the latest video right here over my shoulder, go ahead and click that link. If you want to check us out on our social networks, we're at T3 Body Encinitas. That's T3 Body Encinitas. Or shoot me a quick email at info@T3BodyEncinitas, where our motivation inspires you to be better. See you guys soon.